Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this evening's Lupina Lecture. My name is John Berkman, and I'm the director of the Lupina Center for Spirituality, Healthcare, and Ethics. The Lupina Center is a relatively new center at Regis, just being founded in the last few years. And the Lupina Center, its goal is to work towards a more holistic healthcare in Canada, and particularly in Ontario. And by that, we mean work for a healthcare that more fully and adequately integrates all dimensions of the human person. And we're particularly interested in making sure that healthcare fully and adequately integrates the ethical dimension and especially the spiritual dimension. And to that end, I'm very pleased and honored to welcome to Regis College tonight Dr. Christina Puchalski. Dr. Puchalski has been a real innovator and courageous individual in terms of working in the medical field to integrate spirituality over the last 20 years. There's been a tremendous development, particularly in the United States, over a real suspicion and reluctance to take or to admit spirituality as an integral and important, indeed essential part of medicine. But Dr. Puchalski's work over the last 20 years has made great progress in seeing the spiritual dimension of healthcare as truly an essential part of healthcare. And tonight she'll be speaking about some of those elements. Dr. Puchalski is first and foremost an internist. She's trained as internal medicine and has also works as a geriatrician and palliative care physician, but works across the spectrum of life in her work. Dr. Puchalski founded and is the executive director of the George Washington Institute. Let me make sure I get the name right. The George Washington Institute for Spirituality and Health, otherwise I know it by its acronym, GWISH, which is a leading institute in America for work to integrate spiritual care as an essential part of medicine. So without further ado, I welcome, please all welcome Dr. Puchalski.
But I really appreciate being here, and I want to thank the Lupina Center and the Lupina Foundation for putting this together and for all of you for coming out on this cold night to hear about spirituality as an important part of patient care. And what I hope to do this evening is to lay the groundwork for some of the background for why spirituality and health is becoming a field, not just in the United States, but in Canada and Europe and in Australia and other parts of the world. The one marker of that success is that right now I'm in the midst of co-editing a textbook, an international textbook on spirituality and health. And you sort of know in the academic world when you get to the point of writing a textbook, and there's international collaborators, just how much interest there is in this field. But it has not always been that way. And so I'd like to spend today giving a little bit of a background for how we myself and many colleagues, have tried to create this as an important field of care. I want us to first reflect on what it is that we do as healthcare professionals. And I know this is a mixed audience, and some of you work with patients, others of you are patients yourself or are family caregivers. But when we think of ourselves, our patients, the people that we care for, this image from Betty Farrell's book, The Nature of Suffering and the Goals of Nursing, which she kindly let me use the pictures from this, to me really depicts so much of what we do. My journey as a doctor is a journey with suffering with others and a witness to other people's suffering. And that's what we do. And this is where spirituality is so important. You're going to hear me talk about courses. You're going to hear me allude to some data and some fancy models. But really, it really just boils down to this. It boils down to our ability to provide love and care to the people that we serve. And that's what is the root of why we talk about spirituality and health. Now, when we talk about suffering, what does that mean? What, suffering is sort of a big word, and I tried to put it into some categories. This isn't by all means not limited to these categories, but it's based from my encounters with my patients. The meaning, I'm not the person I used to be. Now that I have this cancer or ALS or diabetes or dementia, I'm not the person I used to be. I've been going through a very poignant personally poignant experience with two of my patients. They're both from a country in Africa. It's a husband and wife, and they've lived in the United States for a long time. Their son was at a meeting, and they had asked their son to come visit them in 2001 in September. And he was on the plane that hit the Pentagon, so he was killed. And they're very, they're Orthodox Christians, and the mother and the father handle things very differently. And dad kind of sees this as a punishment from God. Well, more recently, they were visiting family in their country in Africa, and they were brutally beaten up with knives and hatchet saws and, I mean, all sorts of horrible things. They were evacuated, and I was participating from to help this happen. They went to Frankfurt, and they've had surgery, and they just came back, actually, on Wednesday. And so right before I came up here, I was able to see them in the hospital. And I walk in, and the mom is just smiling, and she has huge scars on her face. One eye doesn't work. Her teeth are missing on one side. Her skull has been bashed in, so she has a plate. Her arms don't work anymore because she had multiple fractures and cuts. But she's just beaming. I'm home with my family. Because that's what's so important to her. She's home with her kids. That's what gives her meaning. Dad is not like that. For him, it's over. I told you. I told you when my son was killed, it's over. And this is the proof of it. He has completely now lost any sense of trying to survive. That is what so many, and maybe not so dramatically, but so many of our patients and our loved ones go through. And this is where I think we may not be able to fix or cure some people, but we can offer an opportunity for healing. And healing, I hope for my patient, is going to be some recognition that God really is there for him. He's a very religious man. Maybe a recognition that his family is really loving and that his life does have some meaning, even though it seems so empty now. So hope, what do I have to hope for? What do my patients have to hope for? What do our patients have to hope for? Why me, why now? It's a very, very, very common question that's asked by many of my patients as soon as they're given a diagnosis, why me? And what do you think the most common answer is from most physicians is, well, you have a gene that causes this and that, or you were exposed to this and that. But really, that may be the question, but it's usually broader than that. It's why is this happening to my life now? I need an answer. I need to make some sense of all of this. Isolation, you know, many of my patients unfortunately feel very isolated when they're ill, usually because we don't fully understand what someone else is going through. But sometimes it's as on the slide. A spouse walks out on them. Family can't handle it. It's too much for them. And so as people feel so terribly isolated, we are the ones that they can connect with. We are the ones that can provide that source of hope, that source of connection for people, that sense of giving them a little bit of control over their life. And it's not just stress and suffering for our patients, it's stress for ourselves too. And there's been a lot of work written about healthcare professionals and the stress that we undergo, including workplace tension. And then Mary Vachon here in Canada wrote about the stress of caring for critically ill and dying patients and how that impacts healthcare professionals. We've talked a lot about the focus of support, of cure rather, and technology rather than support, and how that really puts us in a framework of seeing ourselves as failures when cure is no longer possible, and the kind of stress that kind of mindset affects our work, and then the demands of our environment. So patients have a lot of suffering, and so do the healthcare professionals. So when we talk about healthcare reform, it's something I'm working now with people in Washington, D.C., is how to integrate some of this in any healthcare reform moving forward. It's not just for patients, it's also for us as well. We did a study at University of Cincinnati looking at depression symptoms in residents. And these were residents who were internal medicine, pediatrics, and family medicine. And what we found, unfortunately, is that depressive symptoms are very high in house officers and in interns. But those residents and interns that had better religious coping or higher scores on a spiritual well-being scale, that being a little broader, more broadly defined than religion, tended to have lower depressive symptoms. And so this really was very eye-opening for us and for my colleagues at University of Cincinnati, thinking about, well, what's the role of spirituality with healthcare professionals? And that program is now looking at ways to support and allow expression of residents and interns' spirituality as a way of helping them deal with the stress of healthcare. This is just a slide to remind me to talk a little bit about stress. And I heard a little bit of this today in the smaller group that we had this afternoon. But the role of stress on illness. And it's very, very well documented that stress causes a lot of changes within the nervous system that then can lead to a progression of illness or advancement in an illness. And there's very good data that correlates stress with hypertension, depression, heart disease, and chronic pain. So anything that can help mitigate that stress or help people deal with stress is likely to have beneficial effects. And many of us feel that spirituality also plays a role in that arena. More recently, there's been research in mindfulness, meditation, and relaxation response that has actually shown that certain spiritual practices can lead to a reduction in the negative effects of stress. And just a reminder, in terms of primary care visits, and it's still, the statistics still hold, that 60 to 90% of visits to primary care doctors and practitioners are often stress-related. I know because of the economy in the last 2 years, the number of visits to my office have increased, the number of people coming in with chronic pain, vague symptoms have increased, and I think that's strongly correlated to the stress that people are experiencing. So if we look at healthcare today, and I think I can speak to this more broadly than just the United States, but none of our systems are perfect. And there is an increasingly huge emphasis on evidence-based medicine. Physicians and others are pressured to have shorter visits in order to meet the bottom line. And patients just feel overwhelmed by the system, by the choices, by insurances or other problems within the healthcare system. People are overwhelmed by what they have to do to deal with chronic illness. In fact, in the States, we have something called patient navigators. I don't know if that has come up to Canada or not, but patient navigators are often social workers, but not necessarily, people who help patients navigate the system. They help provide additional support and counseling to patients as they're dealing with the demands of an increasingly complicated system. And why is it so complicated? Because we, you know, in many ways it's a good thing, but we are able to extend people's lives and offer lots of treatment choices and options, and the more information there is, the harder it is to come up with good choices. And then as we approach end of life and are again given all these vast array of choices, we need to have the time and space to say, is this really what I want to do? I was doing a house call earlier this week for a patient of mine who's 92. She probably has a tumor. Her son is also a physician, and we were sitting down and talking about, do we really want to do tests if we're not going to do anything about it? And looking at the variety of choices and ending up fortunately meeting my patient's wishes, which is to be able to die at home and have hospice in place. But all of these things take time and effort, and it's often hard for people to understand how to take all of their values and beliefs and all the possible choices they have and come up with a decision. So it's a very, very complicated system. Here, I think you do a much better job than we do with regard to teamwork. But in the States, we talk about interdisciplinary teams, but in practice, it's not fully implemented. And the fact that things are now on, you know, electronic records, and there's so much distance between us and the rest of the team, that it's a challenge to know how to do that appropriately. I love this quote, which several years ago when I was doing my exams for certification in palliative care, it was in our exam review book, and I was so excited that they would have something spiritual in a review book for palliative medicine. And I think it so speaks to that initial picture that I showed with the person who is suffering. And that is, how well are we listening to our patients, our family members, to each other? Are we just hearing and filtering what we need to hear for the visit, or are we really listening to the whole of the person's story? Who is there in all the world who listens to us? Here I am. This is me in my nakedness, with my wounds, my secret grief, my despair, my betrayal, my pain, which I can't express, my terror, my abandonment. Oh, listen to me for a day, an hour, a moment, lest I expire in my terrible wilderness, my lonely silence. O God, is there no one to listen? And while this is about a person who is dying, the need to be heard and the requirement, I believe, the moral mandate of healthcare professionals to really listen is across all of life. We, I think, and it's so unfortunate that we have to push people into systems where time is not valued in any kind of reimbursement system, where people, I know my colleagues in England now, they're increasing the amount of time for primary care doctors, but where in many systems, primary care practitioners have less than 5 minutes with a patient. We need to value the time, because what the time allows us to do is to really listen to the entirety of that patient's story. And not only is this a nice thing to do because it addresses an issue as this, but it also allows us to build trust with our patients and to get the correct information that we need to make a diagnosis. A patient of mine, a new patient of mine, 29 years old, she's now 30, but she was 29 when she was referred to me, was in a regular family practice. And she happened to be a vet tech where I take my cat, so I knew a lot of the veterinarians there, and I spent a lot of time there with my cats. One of my cats died last year of cancer, and so she was really, we were going there a lot. So they got to know me and my approach. And one day I got a phone call, and they said, would you be willing to consult with one of our vet techs? We think she's not getting a good diagnosis. So I met with this woman, and she had had a history of depression since she was 10, and she was having some chronic headaches, and so she was written off as someone whose headaches were probably caused by her depression. And when I listened to her, I part of me thought that that might have been the dynamic, but as I listened more to her story, there was something in between the words that made me just think that there was something different. I did an exam. I didn't find anything that was abnormal in the exam, but I nevertheless felt I had to get a scan on her head, and she indeed had a big tumor in her fourth ventricle. Now, she was able to have surgery. She has a great outcome, got all of it out. It's very low likelihood of recurrence quickly. I mean, it may recur over many years, but it's operable. But what she and her dad told me was, you listen to us. Nobody took the time to really listen to what Mary was saying, to her concerns. You know, she's an educated person. She's got medical training. She was saying, I think this is more than my depression. Nobody listened. That's so key, and that's also what we're talking about here with spirituality and health, isn't it? It is rooted in our respect and our honoring for another person, our honoring their dignity, the recognition that everyone, no matter who they are, has the right to be heard. And even if someone has very advanced dementia, they're still a human being that deserves our attention and our care. So part of what I'm working on in the Hill in Washington, D.C. is how can we create these more healing environments, and how can that be reflected in any kind of policy that's developed? And clearly, my feeling, as with I'm sure many people in this room, is that we need to see spirituality not just as an add-on, but foundational to what we do. We are all called. We are all called to serve others. How can that be reflected in our healthcare systems? How can that be supported? So there's a concept of total pain that those of you that do palliative care and hospice care will know. This is a quote from Cecily Saunders, who coined the term total pain. She said, people needed the space to be themselves. She said, I coined the term total pain from my understanding that dying people have physical, spiritual, psychological, and social pain that must be treated. So this, I extend that to not just pain, but symptoms in general. That as we experience our own symptoms or stress, as we are dealing with our patients, to be looking at it in this broader framework of what we term the biopsychosocial spiritual model of care. So that, I don't have a picture, but if you think of graphically, if someone's talking about their pain, what percentage might be physical? What percentage might be spiritual? And I have numerous cases, which we could stay until midnight for my relaying these cases to you, of people who scored very high on a scale of 1 to 10 complaining about pain. my pain is 10 out of 10, my pain's 100 out of 10. But when you dig deeper, you find out that, you know, 80% of it comes from despair, 10% comes from isolation, you know, and only 10% actually comes from their tumor or their physical pain. So the need, again, to look at that kind of broader way of looking at patients. So this is another favorite quote of mine. His Holiness the Dalai Lama did a foreword for a book that I edited and wrote called Time for Listening and Caring. And it's an amazing story of how we even got him to do the foreword. But what really moved him when he sent the acceptance was the need for, was how we were expressing compassion and love as so essential in healthcare and the need to provide that. And he wrote, "But it is equally important to encourage the spirit through a constant show of love and compassion. It is shameful how often we fail to see that what people desperately require is human affection. Deprived of human warmth and a sense of value, other forms of treatment prove less effective. Real care of the sick does not begin with costly procedures, but with the simple gifts of affection, love, and concern." And I feel strongly that if we can train our healthcare professionals to be motivated from altruism and from love, then the care that they provide will be better, because there'll be that sense of commitment and care for the other. So the biopsychosocial spiritual model is integrated, and it really implies a team approach. All of us on that team are important. It doesn't say that the doctor is more important than the nurse, that the chaplain is really not part of the team, just the opposite. All of us are equal and all of us are part of that team. So it's integration of this more holistic approach in how we address patients. I understand that Dr. Rita Sharon was here a while back, and Dr. Sharon talks about humanities as a way of approaching some of these issues. And one of the ways that she gets a history from her patient is to say, "I'm going to be your doctor. What do I need to know about all of you, the total of you, to be able to treat you?" And that's this kind of approach, that just because I'm their doctor doesn't mean that I'm only going to be dealing with their physical symptoms. I really need to know about their whole being and what's important to them. Or just because someone is a chaplain doesn't mean that they don't listen to their physical symptoms, because again, we all are dealing with the whole of that human being. I'm not going to go into these studies extensively. I think you've had other speakers deal with this, but I wanted to just put one slide up there to frame this. So what I just did is I shared with you what I learned over many years is probably the most important thing about spirituality and health, which is that it comes from love. It's a compassion-driven service to other. It's a calling. But you know, as it is in most of academia and certainly in healthcare, research is also important, and it can help to make a point about the importance of an area, and also can help define practice and guidelines and regulations and training. So there is some research in this area. It started in religion and mental health and then moved to, done by psychologists mostly, and then the nursing field did a lot of more qualitative research around religiosity and spirituality. Balfour Mount here in Canada is a big leader in looking at spirituality more broadly defined as existential concerns. So that started the move into looking at research beyond religion. So in the first bullet, there are a number of studies that suggest that there are better healthcare outcomes if patients have spiritual and or religious beliefs that might help them cope. We did a study looking at will to live in HIV patients and found that those HIV patients that had either strong spiritual beliefs in a broad definition or religious beliefs tended to have a stronger will to live and tended to do better. One of my colleagues at GW looked at survival in end-stage renal dialysis patients, and again, those patients with spiritual and or religious beliefs tended to have a stronger will to live, to cope better with their illness and to survive longer. Factors such as recovery from surgery are impacted by spiritual and or religious belief. Depression. People who are spiritual tend to have higher levels of hope and less death anxiety. And many people have looked at this, I'm now blanking on Jimmy Holland, is a psychiatrist in New York who's done a lot of study in this area on psychosocial determinants of health, looking also at spirituality. And she, among others, have found that these effects seem to be additive over social support. So what does that mean? One of the explanations for why religion might have positive benefits is that it offers people a community of support. And yet, what we're finding from the studies is that there seems to be something above and beyond just that support factor. What that is, we don't know. Mindset, a value system, etc. And then I mentioned Balfour Mount's work looking at spirituality being associated with greater quality of life with people who were seriously ill if they had meaning and purpose and fulfillment and life goals. And then there's a whole area of research now in mind-body interventions. Mindfulness meditation is one, but people are also mapping areas of the brain that are affected by stress and showing how that can be modulated by certain practices such as meditation, mindfulness, relaxation response. Now, there was a national survey done in 2005 of US hospitals. And the aim of this survey was to find out, we're talking about spirituality, so what are patients' spiritual needs? And this is in order of predominance. So the number one spiritual need that was identified was love and belonging. Again, what we just talked about, that need to connect, love and belonging, followed by meaning and purpose, appreciation of nature and beauty, spiritual or religious practices and guidance in doing those, positivity, gratitude, and peace, and then finally resolution of issues involving life and death. Now, there have also been surveys looking at whether patients really want us to address these issues, and many, many surveys in many different patient populations, pulmonary patients, cancer. This particular study that I'm quoting here is from the Annals of Family Medicine in 2004, and what this group did was to survey their patients in a family practice, asking, do you want your doctor to address your spiritual needs and to integrate them into your treatment plan? And in this particular study, all those different studies that I just talked about, the numbers were between 50 to 85%. In this particular study, this group then asked, if it's yes, I do, then they asked, under what kind of conditions would you want that? If you're dying, if you're just diagnosed with serious illness, all the way down to a history and physical. So 95% said, if I'm dying or just diagnosed with a serious illness. It was 90% suffering from chronic illness or loss, and 85% said being admitted to a hospital for any reason. So for those of you that do hospital-based practice, 85% of patients would like their spirituality addressed, and then 60% on a new history and physical. And then this particular group said, well, why would you want us to do that? Well, it increases trust, helps the doctor understand the patient more, helps the doctor with a treatment plan. Patients felt listened to. So think about that. What happens when, if you are a patient and a doctor is asking you, well, why are you here? Okay, you've had this headache. When did it start? You know, all the kinds of questions we ask. And then asks, do you have any spiritual beliefs? What gives your life meaning? I started this work by developing courses in spirituality and health in medical school. In 1992, we developed one at George Washington University. And prior to that, there were about three schools with courses, but they were mostly on religious traditions and healthcare. And they came out of the two Jesuit medical schools and then one Seventh-day Adventist school, Loma Linda. So they were more focused around religious traditions. And our course was an elective initially and then became part of the required curriculum in 96, was more focused on spirituality more broadly defined. In 1996, I became involved with a program funded through the Templeton Foundation where we gave competitive awards to medical schools in developing curricula. And I think that in part impacted the field. In 2004, we had 100 of the medical schools that had topics related to spirituality in their curriculum, throughout their curriculum. We have since developed, so we really feel we've made an impact there, but I wanted to share, we've also developed competencies. In 1999, we worked with the Association of American Medical Colleges and brought together leading academic physicians and others who teach in medical school and said, what really should be the learning objectives and the outcome goals? I don't have the learning objectives here, that's on our website, but I will share with you the outcome goals, which is, the question was asked, when students are walking across that stage and getting their degree, What do you hope they would have accomplished as a result of these courses? And one is that they would be aware of the spirituality and the need to integrate that into the care of patients in a variety of clinical contexts. The second is that they look at their own spirituality. And this is the first time that anything in the curriculum really focused on their own inner life, what their own spirituality is and how it affects the way they relate to or provide care for patients. And until recently, that's been the hardest thing to teach. But looking more at reflection, a reflective process, and how that might impact the way that they learn how to provide care. And then the biopsychosocial spiritual model is the third, is the awareness that it's not just the physical needs that occur at the end of life and in life in any illness, but also the social, cultural, emotional, and spiritual needs. So one of the ways that currently we have a program, we're developing something called the Jewish Templeton Reflective Rounds, which is again going to be through a competitive process. Canadian schools are welcome to apply as well. We're going to develop a process of reflection in the clinical years for medical students so that we can address that second bullet of they're looking at their own lives. Same thing we do at GW is we have this integrated throughout all 4 years. And in the first year, they develop a service of remembrance and gratitude for the people that donated their bodies for their gross anatomy courses. And as a corollary to that service, they have another part of the required curriculum, a whole session where it's called Reflections on Gross Anatomy, where they have an opportunity to reflect on how they felt about working with someone, a body who had died, a person who had died, what that meant to them, and what kind of issues came up for them. So it's been done in pieces, but we're trying to make this much more of an important part of the curriculum. So in 2009, we brought together our best programs in spirituality and health, and through a consensus process, developed competencies in medical education. And we based those competencies on the ACGME competencies, which are competencies for residency training. And it was a very creative process, 3 days long, sort of a cafe model of doing consensus where people really got engaged. And we looked at how might we teach spirituality within a systems-based context. What's the knowledge that students need to have? What do they need to know in terms of skills with patient care? We created a separate competency in compassionate presence, because we felt that was very different from communication. It overlaps, but it's different from communication. So people often think of compassionate presence as attentive listening, but really most of us feel it moves way beyond that, that it really speaks to that sense of love for the patient and working out of call. Professional development, so again, their own spirituality, and then finally communication skills. In one of our surveys for our medical schools, we've been surveying students over the 4 years to see how our curriculum has affected them. And what we found early on is that while the students really loved the material we taught in the first 2 years, in their third year, which is where they started their clinical work, they felt that what was taught was not reinforced. And that really changed our direction at GWISH to look more at system changes and the recognition that we have to work on all sides of the healthcare system to make changes. And so in 2008, we started some work with hospital settings around the country and brought leadership teams from 7 hospital sites. 5 were, because this was funded by a Catholic foundation, 5 were from Catholic systems, but 2 were for-profit hospitals, not religious. And we brought the leadership teams together. They participated in a 3-day retreat that we led. And then each hospital picked a unit and then developed a variety of interventions. And we attempted to measure outcomes. And I'm saying attempted because each of the 7 sites had such different interventions that statistically it was a challenge to do this. But we did do a pretest where we interviewed, and this is really interesting when we think about spirituality and why I am pretty adamant about saying that we should be very explicit about asking of patients about spirituality. So that we did a survey of all of the staff at these 7 sites and all the patients at the same time before the interventions got started. So the majority of staff said, yeah, it's important to talk about spirituality. We do it. We ask patients about it. And staff included doctors, nurses, chaplains, social workers, OT, PT, everybody that had worked on the test units. Now, interestingly, at that time, 15% of the patients said that professionals had actually asked them about spiritual concerns. So Sylvia McSkimmy, the nurse who was a co-leader with me in this project, and I were very interested in the statistic. And when we did site visits, we just asked people, what's going on that you think, what do you think of this data? And what we found was that people said we're very compassionate, we're very caring. They were. They certainly, in my opinion, provided compassionate care. But what patients want is the opportunity to be able to talk about their spiritual beliefs if they want to. They want to be able to have that ability to say, this is important in my life. Thank you for valuing it. This is what's going on. Thank you for integrating it into my plan, if it's appropriate for each person, obviously. But they want that ability. And that's why I've been somewhat of a stickler about using the word spirituality and about integrating a spiritual history into the regular history. These are just examples of the initiatives that people did, and it really varied. I want to highlight just one, and that is the huddle. The huddle was done at one of our for-profit hospitals in New Mexico, and it was done at the beginning of each shift change. So the nurses brought together anybody who was on that floor, any doctors that were there, OT, PT, the nurses, the social workers, chaplains, and they met in a room. It took less than 5 minutes. So someone read an inspirational reading. Someone shared a good example of a spiritual care story, a patient story that they wanted to share. And then they asked, is there anybody that needs help today? So they brought it back to the team cohesiveness. And then at the end, they just did this compassion, care, commitment, kind of, hands together, and off they went for their day. And a couple of interesting things about that. That has been reproducible now. But also in this particular hospital, what they found was that the call buttons, when patients push call buttons, the frequency of the call buttons went down after this was integrated, a few months afterwards. And so when they asked their patients, we notice you're not really ringing the bell, is everything okay? Well, we just really feel that you're present. We know that you're around. We just feel that sense of being nurtured. So it was an interesting, it was a very interesting experience that, again, supporting the staff and having them really, really be very intentional about their work made a difference. The other was the recognition of intentionality as part of spiritual care. Being very efficient, doing the tasks, but really integrating the patient and the family into that. So being sensitive to creating a healing space was something else that came out of these studies. Some of our outcome measures, our hospitals, in one hospital, two hospital settings actually, in their regular end of the year survey, Prescani is what they used, they found that in one of the sites, the med unit went up over 90%, and in another site, it went up over 80% patient satisfaction. It had been in the 50s and 60s, so they attributed to this. There was a greater sense of cohesiveness, and staff actually felt more rejuvenated as well. So all of this work has led to something that I did with Betty Farrell and a number of colleagues in 2009, where we developed guidelines for spiritual care. We lodged them in palliative care because that's an area where spiritual care has already been defined as essential, but we also defined palliative care as very broad, applying from the time of diagnosis. So really most of our hospital patients would fit in this definition. And we built this on the National Consensus Project guidelines that says spirituality is important. And these guidelines, which were done in the early 2000s, divided palliative care into 8 domains of care. Spiritual, religious, and existential used to be in between psychological and social. They were mixed in there, and they created it as its own domain. So we took that domain and said, why isn't it, it's been around, why are people not doing it? Well, people said they needed tools, and that was the focus then of this work. We brought together leaders from around the country, interdisciplinary, mixed, atheist, agnostic, different religions, et cetera, different healthcare professionals, spiritual care professionals, et cetera. We developed a definition, and then we made some recommendations, and that was published as an executive summary in the Journal of Palliative Medicine in October of 2009. And it was the most downloaded article for that journal for that entire year. So a huge, huge amount of support in this. Part of the process was to bring people together for the conference, to develop these guidelines and models, and then to send that work out to a lot of different organizations who then made suggestions and edits and supported the document. So it really represents a fairly large group of healthcare professionals throughout the country and in the United States. Our definition was very broad. There was a good deal of, as I discussed earlier today, I won't go into all the details, but a good deal of discussion about the words. But we wanted to have a definition that would be something that could be used in this work and certainly in clinical care. And the key points are that spirituality is part of our humanness, our humanity. That it talked about this process of seeking and expressing meaning and purpose, and then the way people experience their connection to the moment, their connectedness to the moment, to self, to others, to nature, and to the significant or sacred. So a very broad definition that includes religion, but includes many other things as well. And how clinically, how people come to understand spirituality, it's developmental, it differs depending where they are in their life and what is happening to them. So even very religious people may talk about meaning and purpose in different contexts. This work also culminated in a book called Making Healthcare Whole, and that actually has been distributed to leaders on the Hill in health policy who've expressed interest in learning more about this. So just to give you a sense of starting in the early 90s, where hardly any of this was mentioned, to people being actively interested in this. I'm going to review this very quickly. If you're interested in the details, you can. I'd be happy to share the paper with you. I know also John has a copy of the paper, and there's more information on this on our website as well. But we wanted the group to think about, how would you define a spiritual care model? What does it mean? And what does it mean in your hospital setting or in your clinical setting? What does spiritual care mean? And in some of the work we're doing now with hospital systems, people define that a little bit differently. A lot of it is dignity-based and respecting patients, but each hospital with their culture puts in different definitions. We talked about the idea of getting a spiritual history and talking to patients and communicating with patients about spirituality, and then integrating that information into a treatment plan. And then the importance of working in an interprofessional team in this arena, with, of course, the board-certified chaplain being the important person with regard to expertise in spiritual care, but everybody on the team addresses it. We talked about training and certification, and then the importance of spiritual development as part of our professional development, and that it tends to get ignored. Where I was motivated to include this is a friend of mine who's a palliative care physician, then studied to be an Episcopal priest. And she called me once from seminary and she said, you know, we're all required to have spiritual directors because of the kinds of issues that come up when we deal with the congregants. Isn't that ironic that in medical school, when we're dealing with life and death and divorce and sadness and suffering, there's no such person for us? So one of the grants that we just got partial funding for is to develop reflection mentors for medical students. So it'd be sort of like spiritual directors, but using language that's a little bit more general. And then finally, quality improvement. We have to do quality improvement in this area to make significant sustainable changes within hospital systems. So here's just some examples of our recommendations regarding spiritual care models. Integral to patient-centered care, honoring dignity. And what the group said was that spiritual distress should be treated with the same intensity as attention to physical distress. So how we all run around now, if someone says, what's your pain on a scale of 1 to 10, we all get into motion if it's above 5, if it's above 4. We are trained, and rightly so, to treat that. But what about spiritual distress? What if someone's spiritual distress is 10 out of 10? What happens to them? And that's what this group said. We have to be attentive, and everybody on the team, from the ward clerk on, should know how to identify that. Some of us are working on making spirituality a vital sign, and in fact, Jimmy Holland in the States is looking at psychosocial factors as a sixth vital sign, with spirituality now being integrated into that as well. This is a very, very busy slide. All it is it's a process model. Starting on this side, when a patient enters into the system, someone has to ask them, they have to do some sort of screening around spiritual issues and whether they're in spiritual distress. And that takes a minimum amount of training to be able to find that out, just generally. sort of the 1 to 10 scale. Then as the patient and family move through the system, those of us that develop treatment plans need to know how to diagnose whether there is spiritual distress and what kind, or to identify spiritual resources of strength in a wholeness model. So that's the spiritual history. The spiritual assessment is done by board-certified chaplains, and those are the experts in spiritual care. And then in the ideal world, we have an interdisciplinary team that's part of that circle over there, an interdisciplinary team that discusses the patient. And in many settings, the patient is part of that, or the family is part of that. So, you know, the chaplain may identify some physical issues that they bring to my attention. I may identify spiritual issues and ask the chaplain what to do with those, etc. So that's a key part of this, is this flow model, which seems simplistic, but it's things that we found clinicians really need to know where to start developing interventions and models. The dotted lines at the bottom, you'll see an arrow that says personal and professional preparation for the rest of us. So we've integrated our own practice into this big model. And the dotted lines refer to the fact that there is a change that occurs in the healing encounter. And that I'm not only making a change in my patients' lives, they make changes in mine all the time. And we need to be open to that dyad, to that relationship. And we also need to be supported in that as well. In the bottom line for the assessment is that there need to be tools. We need to have screening tools. We need to have history tools. Staff members need to recognize distress, as I said. There needs to be documentation also by chaplains in the chart. And you know, our chaplains were really challenged by these participants. They said, if there's a chaplain referral, we expect a response within 24 hours. Now, this has actually impacted some hospital administrators who have almost gotten to the point of hiring more chaplains. When their chaplains come in and say, this is what doctors and nurses and social workers are expecting of us. They're expecting a 24-hour response, but there's only two of us for 800 patients. You know, so this document has also been used to try to help hospitals recognize the importance of spirituality. This is a tool I developed with a number of physicians. If you're interested, on our website, we actually have a DVD that is about 15 minutes long to learn how to use it. It's not that complicated, though. The idea was to develop, what is it that doctors and nurses need to know? This is not for chaplains, this is for us. What's sort of the basic things? We need an opening question. Do you have spiritual beliefs that help you? And then contextualize it with what you're going through now or dealing with stress. What gives your life meaning? So that's kind of the opening. The I is to listen for how important those beliefs are and whether they influence how the person cares for themselves. The C is, do they belong to a spiritual community? Church, temple, mosque, like-minded friends, family, the yoga group, think broadly. And then A, when we first developed this in the 90s, one suggestion was that we as the clinicians could say, how would you like me to address these issues? But now that we have that other model, we're encouraging nurses and doctors to think in terms of the treatment plan and assessing it. And one can still ask that. I think it's a good question, but it's moved to include A as part of the assessment. This tool, by the way, has been validated recently. We're working with Betty Farrell and her group at City of Hope. We do have some metrics on this tool now, so there is some standardization. The treatment plan, again, what was the challenge in this discussion is diagnosis codes. Is if we're going to take the time to talk about spirituality, how does that get reimbursed? How does that code get coded for? So that none of this has been developed. This is all a recommendation that we start thinking about spiritual distress and these discussions in a way that can be billed for or acknowledged in the note and in our time spent. And that's also going to be very important for chaplains as well. Thinking about treatment plans, always considering the spiritual care referral as really number one. And in this paper, we go into it a little bit more about how one might distinguish between spiritual and psychological, but that's very much an area under development. And then discharge plans of care should also include spirituality. So when my patients leave the hospital and go to long-term care or rehab, ideally, the chaplain from the hospital is calling the chaplain or the spiritual care professional at the long-term care site and relaying what the plan might be. This was a patient of mine who was an advocate for the homeless, and she had suffered a stroke that left her with mild cognitive impairment and hemiparesis. And when I asked her spiritual history, the first thing she said is, I'm a card-carrying atheist. I asked her what gave her life meaning, and she said, my work. Look at me now. I have no meaning. I can't do what I did. And so it was very, very difficult for her to deal with her stroke because of that. So her issue really was around meaning. And so there's her FICA summary. What came up in, I think it was the second or third visit, was a medical student was with me and very spontaneously said to her, you know, I've really been interested in working with the homeless. And so she started telling him things. And in that interaction, she saw possible legacy building. So she actually became a teacher and started teaching a lot of the medical students and now college students and others how her work might be carried on. So this is just a simple example of how something like this might work. And then her treatment and plan, and I'm encouraging people to think again in this holistic way, is to be writing all of these dimensions, not just to say she's got hemiparesis and mild cognitive impairment, let's do physical therapy and rehab, but to think about all those other aspects of her life as well, and to bring that into the treatment plan as well. In terms of the recommendations about interprofessional considerations, there was a real call for policies on how we should respect each other and communicate with each other effectively. Again, speaking to the need for board-certified chaplains being an integral part, and also recommending workplace activities to enhance the spiritual aspects of care. And then respecting healthcare professionals should also be reflected in the policies of the hospital. So if you really respect your workforce and you want them to take care of themselves, how is that going to be put into action? We've talked about competencies and the need for standardized competencies and referred to some of the competencies that are already available, hours in medical education. The Curie Center, the UK Center, came up with a set of standardized competencies as well. We have a summer institute every year. There's some flyers on that where we do intensive teaching in this model and others. And then we talked about personal and professional development and the need for encouraging a time of self-reflection and quiet. So how many of our hospital sites that are trying to do this, to implement this work, are trying to figure out ways to give staff that space to take time for themselves. Even as basic as taking the bathroom on the ward and painting it and putting inspirational readings all over it, and because people know when they go to the bathroom, hopefully no one's going to disturb them, and so that's one place where they can be quiet. And it sounds really funny, but actually it works. It allows people that space to just be themselves for a few minutes in the midst of stress. And then the real call for research here, looking at spiritual care and quality improvement plans. And this is a real opportunity for chaplains who want to do research, is to talk to people in your hospital who are doing QI projects and how one might integrate the work that you're doing. And certainly there's a lot of funding. I want to just close with what we're doing right now with Archstone, City of Hope, and ourselves. We're working in California around these four target areas. We have 9 hospitals now that are heavily in the midst of integrating and doing pilots in care models, assessment, treatment plan, and quality improvement. And it's really a process evaluation. So they're integrating a spiritual history, and they are measuring how many patients are actually receiving that, whether it gets documented, how well the system works, how many chaplain referrals are there. And what we're already seeing is there's many more referrals and there's capacity. So this kind of data, again, shows the need for having adequate staffing and spiritual care. This is just an example of one of the sites. So they're formalizing a spiritual assessment process that's in alignment with the hospital's mission and vision. They're adding a dedicated social worker to their palliative care unit, and they're increasing their chaplain position from a 0.2 FTE to a full-time chaplain. They're fully training all of the clinical members in the use, in their palliative care team, in the use of assessment and reevaluation. The chaplains are shadowing nurses to look at workflow of referrals from palliative care to spiritual care. So chaplains are very active in that whole process of referral and how that gets handled. And then teams are reviewing all the tools so that they can add them to their electronic records. So that's an example of one of the sites. And they're all doing different things. So our hope really is that these demonstration projects will serve as a model for others. And in addition to the California sites, we at GWISH are also working with a number of hospital systems around the country and the U.S. doing similar types of work, where we're bringing people together for a retreat and trying to help them develop quality improvement projects and other projects around this model. I wanted to highlight our website. We do have something called Source on our website, which is a spirituality online education and clinical resource center, where people are posting different tools, assessment models, treatment models, the narratives, cases that can be used for teaching. So if you have that and you want to submit things, please do that through our website. We are interested in highlighting as much work as possible. We do get a lot of hits to this site, so your work would get a lot of visibility. So in conclusion, I hope what I've done today in giving you this overview of a very big area of work is that spiritual care really is an essential element of care, and it's so important in improving quality care for our patients on many different levels. Patients want their spirituality addressed, and we're trying to provide ways in which that can happen, and there's some research that actually indicates potential outcomes, positive outcomes on health. Chaplains, board-certified chaplains, absolutely have to be part of the interdisciplinary team. I think I've tried to make a case for ongoing screening and assessment and integrating spirituality into a treatment plan. And then education, and the most important, is as we get all of these different hospital sites and other clinical sites developing these interventions, that we hope we can get to a point where we'll be able to have these recommendations in place with our clinical sites, with accountability measures for all staff in spiritual care. Our real goal with all of this is culture change. We are hoping to transform healthcare with this intense focus on spiritual care as being foundational to healthcare. And we believe we can do that. We've seen glimpses of it in our hospital systems, and we think that as a group throughout, you know, the States and Canada and England, where people are doing this right now, that we can collectively improve the care that our patients receive. Bishop Desmond Tutu spoke to us for a fundraiser that the University of George Washington did for the Cancer Institute. And he's, if any of you have seen him, he's a very, very big man. And that whole event was all about the data in cancer, and they were honoring some researchers. And then he gets up, and in his booming voice, he said, "What all of you do is spiritual work. It is spiritual work that you do, nothing else." You know, and it was just, you know, you could just hear a pin drop. And he talked about this work. He said, this is spiritual. It is nothing else than that. It is the most important thing. And he says, if you just take this data and you don't do the spirituality, you're missing it. You're missing the care that you can give. And so I want to close with a favorite quote of mine from Dan Silmacy in his book, The Rebirth of the Clinic. "Under this new medical covenant, a spiritual scientific practitioner would affirm that the transcendent is made manifest at the edge of the surgeon's knife, at the tips of the palpating fingers of the pediatrician, in the firm handshake of the internist, in the birth of a child whose unwed mother has AIDS, in the tears of the woman who feels a hard lump in her one remaining breast, and in the vacant stare of the elderly man with dementia. A spiritual scientific practitioner would affirm that the transcendent is there when disease and suffering are recognized together, when the hand that performs the spinal tap distills compassion into the needle's point, the objectivity of science with the subjectivity of God's healing will, the particularity of the case at hand with the universality of a profession under oath, the finitude of the moment and the infinity of a life lived in the service of love. Thus might the clinic be reborn." Thank you very much for your attention.